afternoon for you all. Are you feeling comfortable? It's a packed room, and I saw people are leaving because there are no seats. Before I'm going to start the session, I want to tell you a story, a real story from my past. It was 5 years ago when my VP, my vice president of the company I work for, came to me because I'm leading the web department. And he said to me, "Gil, we have two directions that I want you to pick. One is very sexy, very cool. It's a technology that comes from Microsoft. It is called Silverlight. And the other one is something, I don't know how to say that. It's specification, W3C, the conservatorium that writes specification, things like that." So I said to him, "Ishai, sexy, whatever. Sexy, whatever. I'm going to whatever." 5 years later, where is Silverlight? Anyone saw that platform? Microsoft killed it. And HTML5 is something that is kicking, and it's driving the modern web forward. And this is what we are I'm going to talk about. I'm going to introduce what is those specification in HTML5. Since it's an overview session, I won't drill down to a lot of things. I'm going to talk about a few highlights in HTML5 that I think that everyone needs to know about. And tomorrow I'll have another session that I'm going to drill down into one specific thing in HTML5. Okay, so if you don't know me, I'm Gil Fink. I'm working as a senior consultant and architect for a company called Sela Group. I'm a Microsoft MVP in the last 5 years. I wrote a book about Pro single page application development. If you want to know about SPAs, come and talk to me later on. Okay, I'm not going to talk about SPAs in this session. I'm also the writer of 4 Microsoft official courses. One of them is HTML5 programming. So I wrote different 4 books that you won't ever notice that I've written them, because Microsoft doesn't give you the credentials to put your name on the cover. Okay, that's Microsoft. What we are going to do in the 1 hour and 30 minutes that we are having is talk about what is HTML5. And to me, HTML5 is modern web, okay? That's what HTML5 means to me, and I hope that it will mean to you after I finish this this talk. Later on, I'm going to talk about new elements. That's not the sexiest thing about HTML5, but you need to know what are the new elements and how to use them while you are programming. Later on, I'm going to talk about the big thing in HTML5, which is HTML5 JavaScript APIs. If you are not JavaScript fan like me, okay, you are going to not like my demos, because they include a lot of JavaScript. Yes, HTML5 brings a lot of new JavaScript APIs, and when I say a lot, it's 56 different APIs that you need to know. I'm not going to talk about all of them. I'm going to talk about, I think, 4 or 5 APIs. Then I'm going to talk a little bit about what is CSS3 and what it means to you. Okay? And we'll wrap up the session. I'll have a question and answer. And we'll summarize the session. Okay, so what is HTML5? What do you know about HTML5? Somebody told me that HTML5 is the Flash killer. Yes, it is. Okay, one of the things that brought the HTML5 to recognition by the community is a sentence that Steve Jobs told the newspapers. It is something like, Over my dead body, Flash would be in iOS. Okay, so he is now dead. But still, Flash isn't supported in iOS. And this sentence was said, I think, in 2009. And you can see that from that point of time, HTML5 gained a lot of attention. HTML5 is just HTML, CSS, and JavaScript. So if you've written HTML, CSS, and JavaScript, we are 70% of the way to know what is HTML5. Okay? It depends on HTML4, the early specification that were wrapped up in 1997. Okay? And everybody says that HTML5 is the future of the web. I'm telling you, it's not the future of the web, it's the web. Okay? Definitely. And it is still under development. I mean, not all the specifications that I'm going to talk about are recommendation yet. Still, browsers like Chrome, Firefox, even Internet Explorer supports HTML5 and HTML5 APIs, but not all of them. Okay, so you need to understand what is supported and what is not. And more than that, a lot of specification change during time. There is one interesting thing about what happened with a specification called WebSockets, I think 3 years ago, that the WebSocket protocol version jumped 4 versions in 2 weeks. And that broke, I think, most of the websites that used WebSocket back then. Okay, so you need to know what is supported in browsers, and you need to understand that not everything is supported in the browsers. So why you should use HTML5? And this is the really big question. So first of all, we have a lot of new HTML elements. Not sexy, okay, sorry. But those elements help you to write your page structure more accurate, and it helps a lot to accessibility, searchability, and interoperability, okay? Because you have a way to communicate with other developers, and you don't need to use attributes like ID or class name or whatever to express what you want to express. As I said, we have 56 different JavaScript APIs that you can use right now in the browsers. You just need to know that what are the specifications and what they are going to give you. And I'm going to say a lot. And of course, CSS. A lot of things that you could have done with CSS in CSS 2.1, you still can do it with CSS 3, but CSS 3 brought a lot of new models into the world of the web. And you can even do transitions, animations, transformations, 2D or 3D transformations, etc., etc. A lot of cool stuff you can do with CSS. So what HTML5 include? So the first thing you can see here is semantics. We have new elements. We have structure elements. We have inline new elements. We have elements that help you to build the web page that you're building more accurate, more expressive, without those div elements all over the place. You know, div. You see that in websites. I open a lot of websites with my developer tools in my favorite browser, Chrome, and what you see is like an arrow, div. Okay? No need for that anymore. And we'll see those elements later on. Offline and storage. I'm not going to talk about offline and storage a lot because tomorrow I'm having a session about data-driven HTML5 applications. There I'm going to talk about those storage options. Okay? You can use databases in your front-end using JavaScript, and you can take your application offline. I mean offline that the application is working even if you don't have connectivity. So come to my session tomorrow and you'll hear about it more. Device access. Device access is one cool thing that you can do with HTML5. I'm going to show you today geolocation, how to track your users using the browser, but geolocation is just one device access option. You can access your webcam, your mic, and a lot of other devices, even the vibration in my phone, I can access using JavaScript. You just need to know that there are APIs to do that. Connectivity. Who hit the wall trying to do a cross-domain JavaScript request? Raise your hand, please. Okay, so once you want to do a cross-domain request using JavaScript, browser will block you. It's a security thing. And HTML5 brings cross-origin resource sharing, which is an API that enables you to do cross-domain requests. It brings WebSockets that we are going to see later on in this session, which helps you to open TCP sockets on the client and on the server and communicate to, using sockets and not HTTP. You have server-sent events, a mechanism that helps you to send by pushing notification to the client. You have a client object that syncs those push requests and you can get those things from the server by a push protocol. And a lot of other ways to communicate. Multimedia. Who likes to use video and audio in the browser? We all do that using Flash or Silverlight. So now with HTML5, and we'll see that in the session later on, you can use video and audio as first-class citizens in your web pages. 3D and graphics. You have two models for graphic representation in the browsers, in the browser. One is Canvas, we will see it later on, and one is SVG, scalable vector graphics, using vector graphics to create graphics on your web pages. Performance and integration. How many threads do JavaScript run? Question to you all. One. The UI thread. So how can you create concurrency using JavaScript? Okay, up until HTML5, you could mimic concurrency using set timeout and set timeout functions. Today, you don't have to use them. You have other means, and I'm going to talk about web workers in this session. And last thing is, of course, CSS3, which brings a lot of ways to lay out your web pages, to style them, and of course, other things like animation, transition, transformation, etc. Okay? So all of this is coming and is supported by most of the modern browsers already. You just need to know that. So I'm going to show you a little bit of demos, things that were written in HTML5. I'm going to start with a game, because I'm again lover, you see my Alienware. Who knows Cut the Rope? Where is the internet when you need it? Responsive web design. They erased the play button right now, because the resolution is too small for the game to work. Okay, so let's move on to another thing. Who loves Tron Legacy, the movie? Yes, no hands. Oh, okay, two hands. Sorry, it was a crappy movie. This is a comics written by Microsoft team for Internet Explorer. Everything is written in Canvas. Okay, I can open the developer tools and show you that all the things that you see here is written in JavaScript and images. So you have a really cool comics here with live animation, things like that. You see the lightning there that comes down, things like that. And this comics is interactive. You can click the places here and get information and things like that. You see that you hear the audio. They are using audio tag of HTML5, and that's cool. Once upon a time, I wanted to be a DJ, okay? Didn't work for me. I'm here talking to you. But wheelsofsteel.net enables you to create your own... If you want to be a DJ, a cool site to work with. But this is an HTML5 website. It is written with code in JavaScript, and most of it is using JavaScript. Okay? So I hope that those websites, not the game that I couldn't show you, give you a direction what you can do with HTML5, and it's a lot. You see a lot of games developed in web browsers, a lot of interaction sites, a lot of things that come out from a modern web. Okay, so HTML5, as I said, it's the modern web. So now we are going to delve into HTML5 and to talk about the little things that are included in HTML5. So the first thing is structural elements. Okay? As I said, when you open websites in developer tools, you see arrows of divs, div. I call it divits. Everything is a div. And we are doing that because we are used to do that. Google conducted a research, I think, 4 or 5 years ago to see what developers do. And one of the interesting things that they saw is that, first of all, we invented a language inside of those divs. We have IDs equals header, IDs equals footer. Something like 60-70% of the website use those IDs or class names. You see those. We use navigation, nav, navigate, navigation. Again, with class name or ID. We use things like links or sidebar or things like that. We invented a language because HTML4 didn't give us such a language. So what you can do? In order to do something with that, W3C invented a lot of new structural elements. These elements are block elements. Elements like article, that represent an article or a post inside of a web page. Elements like footer, that doesn't mean that you need to put one footer inside of your web page, but you can use it to footer an article or footer a post or something like that. You can use elements like header to represent a header that includes heading, that includes navigation, whatever what you want to include inside of it. You have the element nav, which is very important because crawlers like Google crawler use those elements to understand where you put all the links, your relevant links. And if you put the links inside of a nav, you get a page rank which is a little bit higher than without the nav tab. And of course, section, the new competitor for div, because everybody are using divs or sections, it's a section inside of your web page. And these aren't only the only structural elements that included in HTML5. There are 32 new elements. Okay. Other elements, inline semantic. If I said that we have block elements, these are inline semantic elements. For example, who used a span with the ID of yellow or class of yellow to mark something in his web page? Raise the hand. Okay, so you have the mark element to do that instead. And the browser will mark with yellow your content. Okay? You have the mirror element that can help you to put some gauge for measurement inside of the web page. It's native in the browser. Okay? You see that this is what is going to be rendered by most of the browsers. Who used a progress bar in his web page? Use the widget for that? No need. You have the progress element to do that. You of course need to write a little bit of JavaScript to change its value, but you have progress bar element. You have output element to indicate that this is an output of a calculation or something like that. And of course, there is the time element that marks that the time that you see is very crucial. And it's very crucial for crawlers that you indicate that something inside of your content is relevant or very very important to you. Mark it with time and you get it inside in the crawler. New input types. HTML5 brings a lot of input types. Have you used a regular expression to validate email? Say yes.
Yes.
Yes. Have you used regular expression to validate URLs? Yes. No more. The validation is out of the box with those new elements. Tells the browser that it's a telephone number, okay? It doesn't do anything else. Number, you can see here it is validating that everything that you put inside of the text box is a number. If it's not a number, it won't get in most of the browsers. Don't expect Explorer to behave like everybody else. Range puts you a slider that you can pick something inside of a range. Search just indicate that it's a search box. Once upon a time, Google Chrome put a magnifier icon inside of it, but today they are not putting it. So just mark that something is search text box. And of course, color gives you a color palette that you can pick, or you have date pickers natively inside of the browser. You just need to pick the right date picker in order to enable users to pick the dates. Okay, so with all of these input types, we need a lot of new attributes. For example, min and max helps you to validate the minimum and maximum value that a text box can get. Multiple, how many times did you hit the wall to create a multiple in text boxes, file input text boxes, how many times did you try to pick more than one file? Before multiple, you needed to create that interaction. Now just put multiple and you can pick more than one file. Pattern enables you to do validation according to some pattern. Okay? Placeholder, it's a placeholder, it's a data that is put inside of an empty text box. Once you press something inside of the text box, the placeholder is erased. Required tells the browser that this text box is required, and it won't post to the server if you try to post it. And of course, step is more relevant to range. For example, to say I want a slider that has steps of 2 and instead of 1 or 3 or 4, whatever, what you like. So in order to understand those, let's see a little bit of demos. Before I start the demo, one thing I want you to notice is this doc type. Okay? Not doc type HTML tells the browser to use HTML5. You don't have to use those DTD script modes, whatever, those things that only one person in your company knows to write it by hand. Okay? Just put not doc type HTML and you're on the way to HTML5. Of course, if you're not working with the specification and you put it in your web page, the web page might break. So don't change every web page before, or test the web pages before you upload them to the production server. In this web page, I'm using a lot of structural elements in HTML5. For example, here is the header element, here's the section, here's the article, here's the navigation, that. And of course, I have a big navigation here, and a footer. This webpage is not interesting at all, and if I run it, you just see some. But the most interesting thing in this webpage is this. I can edit the text which is inside of the paragraph. Why I can edit it? Okay, you probably didn't see the content editable attribute. Okay, so you can create a paragraph or div which is editable using the content editable and just put it and make it a text box. So these are the new structural elements. Again, not very interesting, but you need to know that. Another thing is, I said we have inline semantic elements. So here are the inline semantics. For example, we have a mark element here. We have a meter element here with min and max equals to 0 and 200. The current value is going to be 60. And there are other attributes like optimum. It's the optimum number that the text box can get. Here is a progress element that includes a maximum value of 100 and its current value 50, so we are 50% on our way. And here is the output element. Running this web page, we see the mark, the meter, the progress, and in order to see that the output here is going to work, here it is. One interesting thing about this is I said that there are problems in support. So, hello Internet Explorer 11, no meter, okay? The progress looks a little bit different. The mark is working, and here we won't get the output because the code, the JavaScript code that should have worked in Explorer isn't working. So, as I said, there are pitfalls in HTML5. I'm going to talk about them later on. The last form in the examples, is a form that includes all the input types that I've talked about. For example, here's the color input type. We get a palette of colors. We have the range here. The transform 0 to 10, and the step here is 2. We'll see that in the code later on. We have the number that has also stepped 2. So it runs from 2 to 10. If I'll put A and I'll try to submit, okay, so I have a required attribute on this field. Let's fill it. This is natively from the browser, okay? It's not using jQuery UI or Telerik components or anything else. OK, Okay, please enter a number. You should write a number inside of this element. For example, I'm using the email, and please include at in your email, etc., etc. It's doing a validation for me. Here you can see also the placeholder attribute working, enter phone, enter email, whatever. The last thing that I want to show you is this. This is looking like an autocomplete. Just a moment. Fine. Should have worked like an autocomplete, but it's not. This element, this text box element, uses a data list element. I'm going to show you later on in the code, which is a new element in HTML5 that helps you to create data lists on the client side in order to create lists for text boxes to show you whether in dropdown or as autocomplete. So let's jump into the code and see what it's including. Okay, so I talked about the data list. Here it is. You have a data list element. It includes options. Don't forget the ID, because later on, if I want to impose this data list inside of an input type, I need to say the list attribute equals to the ID of the data list. Okay, so this is the data list element. As I said, we have date input type with the required. You saw the validation pops out when I try to submit the form. We have a month, time, date time, and date time local. The telephone input type, the email, the number, the range, search, color, whatever, everything that you saw. So we have a lot of new HTML5 elements, and you can use them to create things natively in the browser. But, as I said, not everything is ordered in the browser. So what can you do? First of all, you can use those input types, for example, and you have fallback. If the browser doesn't recognize that an input type is, for example, a datetime, it just prints out, renders text box. Okay, this is a fallback inside of the browser. Once you understand that the browser doesn't support anything, you can use polyfills. Polyfills are JavaScript libraries that gap the problem inside of your web page. You have polyfills for most of the HTML5 APIs that you can find. Okay? One place that you can find a list of polyfills is in GitHub. There is a list that Paul Irish, a very interesting guy working for Google, published and used that list in order to understand which polyfills are available for you. So we talked about structural elements, inline elements, input types, etc. Let's go on and let's talk about multimedia. Multimedia is supported as first-class citizen in HTML5. That means that you have a video tag and an audio tag that you can use in order to show videos inside of your web page. So this is an example of a video tag pointing to a video.mp4. And the video tag is working with standard codecs. It supports MP4, or should I say H.264 codec. It supports WebM, so WebM is supported in Chrome. It supports OGG, that is supported in Firefox, and a lot of other standard codecs. If you have a proprietary codec, it won't work, sorry. Okay. Most of the companies doesn't use proprietary codecs. You can use this element as an HTML element, and as an HTML element, it's scriptable, meaning that you can use JavaScript to interact with the video tag. Okay, and the video tag exposes a lot of events that you can wire into. For example, on video end, meaning the video ended, do something. Okay, you can use video API in order to play the video, pause the video, and etc. It doesn't have a property that called can use type or something like that that answers you with maybe, perhaps. Okay, these are real strings that it's going to return to you. Okay, it's in the specifications. Except from video, as I said, we have an audio tag. The audio tag has the same attributes like the video tag, except for three or four properties that you can't use. For example, poster, because you don't have a poster for an audio. You can use the audio tag, which is again scriptable like any other tag, with MP3 and AAC. Audio OGG, of course, is also supported in audio. And let's see a demo, show you how to use it. So let's start with the video tag. Here you can see a video tag with three different sources. Okay, if you are not using the SRC attribute, use the source element in order to say that you have a source with a type of, for example, MP4, WebM, OGG. Okay. For example, Explorer doesn't support WebM and OGG. So if you use those sources with Explorer, then they're not going to work. And Chrome doesn't support MP4, if I'm not mistaken. Or it's supported if you install some addition to Chrome. So what I'm suggesting is if you're going to use the video tag, encode the videos that you have in three different sources. Okay, you can see here the trailer, WebM, OGV, and MP4, and use the source element inside of the video. Another thing that I wanted to talk about is your in all the browsers like IE6, 7, and 8, video tag isn't supported. So if those browsers get stuck into a video tag, they just ignore it. So what you can do is put something like your browser doesn't support video, or flash fallback, or object fallback, in order to show the users your video. So this is another thing that you can do with the video, with fallbacks out of the browser. Okay, so this is the video. You can see buttons, play, pause, and toggle mute. I have a JavaScript file here that it's being loaded with the web page. You can see here things that I'm going to talk about in my workshop on Friday. For example, immediate executed function. This is the syntax for immediate executed function. Once the interpreter of JavaScript hit that function, it will execute it at once. Okay, it's good for creating scopes inside of JavaScript. You can also see here the window add event listener, don't want it loaded. If you are using jQuery, who uses jQuery? If the ready function in jQuery just wire into don't want it loaded, okay, that means that all the DOM, the document object model, was loaded in the browser. If it doesn't find it, because it's a new event in HTML5, it's going to wire the event into the load on load event of the web page. Okay. So once the DOM is loaded, I'm doing this loaded function, which is going to get the element of the video, and then wire event listener to errors inside of the video. I'm handling the errors that might happen. I'm also wiring the buttons that you saw in the HTML to play using the video.play function, or pause the video, or mute, which is a property inside of the video that I'm toggling. Okay, so let's see the web page in action. Let's play. We have a video here. I can pause it, still play it, toggle, don't hear anything, toggle again. These are the browser controls natively implemented in the browser. Okay, nice. And let's take a look at the audio here. Again, we have a fallback if audio isn't supported. I'm going to play some audio. That's simple. Just have a tag for that, put the source, and you're on. So those new elements help you to create multimedia inside of your web pages, and you can do that without the need for Flash or Silverlight or any other plugin in order to show videos and audio to your users. The last element that I'm going to talk about is the canvas. The canvas is a new element, a new block element that enables you to create graphics using JavaScript. It doesn't keep the state, so once you draw something, it doesn't remember that you draw it, okay? But it can create a lot of interesting things. For example, you saw the demo of Tron Legacy, the comics. It is all written in canvas, okay? So you can do fascinating stuff with the canvas element. You can write 2D graphics and even 3D graphics inside of the element. You just need to know that we have something like 56 functions and properties that inside of the that's supported by the canvas element. Again, you can see in this slide that once you use canvas, if the browser doesn't support the canvas, put a fallback inside of the canvas element. And all the things that you are going to do with canvas are being done using JavaScript. That means that you're going to retrieve the element from DOM, get the canvas context or graphic context. Here it's 2D. If I want to use 3D, I need to use another API which is called WebGL, okay, which is supported from IE 11 at last. And once I have the context in hand, I can draw things on the canvas. Okay, so you have a drawing surface that you can draw things. It's pixel based, so it's not if the screen is going getting wider or smaller, what you draw doesn't look well, okay? But it's something that you must remember once you use canvas. Let's see a little bit of demos how to use the canvas element. So the first demo is going to be simple. In the web page, I have a canvas element, and I put a style inside of it in order to show you the border of the canvas. Okay? One thing to notice is the width and height here. If you put the width and height in style, it won't work. Okay, so canvas enforces you to put the width and height on the element itself. You can also see here a reference to a library called Modernizer. I want to stop here and talk a little bit about what is Modernizer, because it's very important if you are going to write HTML5 in your web pages. Modernizer is a small library that detects HTML5 and CSS3 if they are supported or which thing is supported by the browser. It exposed that, that detection in the modernizer object. It's a JavaScript object that you can use. And it has a very, very simple API. Modernizer dot, for example, canvas returns if canvas is supported by the browser or not. Okay, so you have, I'm calling it the information center for HTML5 supporting your browser, and then you can pick whatever fallback you want to pick if that API or that element isn't supported by your browser. Okay. Another thing that I want to show you in this in the website of Modernizer is the documentation tab, and as I said, there is a polyfill list written by Paul Irish, which also wrote Modernizer. So go to the documentation, and the first link here is polyfills, and you will find a very big list of polyfills for HTML5. Okay, the no bullshit guide to HTML5 fallbacks. Here are polyfills for SVG, for Canvas, for example. If you want to use Canvas today, web storage, we'll talk about it tomorrow, sectioning, video, etc., etc. So a very big list, and you should use it. Use, of course, Modernizer. Let's go to the JavaScript file called simple.js. And here it is. So I again wire the add event listener to DOM component loaded. And here you can see me using the rectangle and diagonal functions. Inside of them, I'm using Modernizer. Modernizer.canvas, is canvas supported? If it is supported, I'm grabbing it from the DOM. I'm getting the graphic context to draw on the canvas. And what I'm doing here is just setting a fill style in order to fill the what I'm the thing that I'm drawing with the red, green, blue, and the alpha, which is these numbers. And once I set the fill style, I'm just filling a rectangle in this spot, x 50 and 2. And 250 with width of 150 pixels and height of 100 pixels. And the diagonal here is creating a path, okay? A path is a non-closed element in graphics, so if you want to draw something which is not an not a shape or something like that, then use path. You need to start by beginning the path. You move the cursor of the context to a point. Here I move it to the 0, 0 point, the left upper corner of the browser. And then I'm drawing a line to the point 500 and 500. The line width will be 5 pixels. It is going to be red, and I'm stroking it, meaning that all the things that I've done here aren't drawn on the canvas until I set the canvas stroke or fill. Fill will fill the element that I draw. Stroke will write its border. Then I close the path. Okay, let's see what's the result of this script. Okay, so we have a rectangle here and we have a diagonal written in the canvas itself. I have another example of using Canvas. Again, we have the same settings for the web page, so let's drill down into what I'm doing here. I have a pattern and a text. So you can create patterns inside of the canvas. You can load images into the canvas. You even can load videos to the canvas. Okay? You can do that, but you will see only one frame. You will need to set an interval and then to write the videos every 16 milliseconds or something like that, in order that the eye of your user will see that it's flowing or flooding well. Okay, so in order to create a pattern, I'm loading an image. I'm using the context.createPattern function to create a pattern. You see here that I'm giving it an image and I'm repeating. Repeat it on the X and on the Y inside of the canvas. Repeat X will repeat the image only on the X. Repeat Y will repeat it only on the Y. Then I draw a rectangle inside of the element itself. I'm giving the fill style, the pattern that I created. Once you don't do anything with the pattern, it just wasted memory. And I fill the pattern here. In order to write text, you can create fill text or stroke text. These are functions that write text to the canvas. Again, you need to put the text in the right place. You need to calculate the text that you are writing and things like that, because text isn't supported by the graphics mode. And here is the web page after I've used it. Okay, we have Sonic here, repeated X and Y, and we have the stroke text and fill text. So this is the canvas element, and let's go on with SVG or scalable vector graphics. I said there are two modes, graphic modes in the browser. One is the canvas pixel based, the other one is vector based, and it's SVG. SVG isn't new. Okay, it was supported by, for example, Explorer 5. Okay, the big thing about SVG is the 1.1 edition that came out in 2009. That edition enabled people to use SVG very well. It wasn't adapted until 2009, until that edition. What you can do with SVG is you use element, DOM element, to express your graphics. What I mean is, for example, you have an SVG surface, and you write a rectangle inside of that surface, and another rectangle, and the browser will render those rectangles. And you can see that if the blue rectangle was written after the red rectangle, and then it will show on top of it in the graphics that you are creating. Okay? SVG does include state because you have elements that you use. And you can use JavaScript to manipulate the SVG, to remove elements, to draw elements, to add elements, and of course to do animation. Let's take a look at SVG. So I'm going to start with this simple example. You can see here a lot of SVG elements. The first one draws two rectangles, the thing that you saw in the slide. Second one draws a rectangle, a polygon, and a circle. You just need to know how to draw them using, for example, the width and height of the rectangle or a circle. You use the arc to express the radius, and CX and CY, where is the middle of the circle, etc. You can create inside of SVG definitions, for example, a linear gradient. I'm creating a linear gradient that later on I'm using to fill a rectangle. And you can use it, the definitions for patterns and other very cool stuff. Okay, here is the web page. We have both of the rectangles here. Here's a bird. Yeah, I'm not such an artist. here is a rectangle with the linear gradient, and here is the pattern that I draw that includes the rectangles and circles inside of an ellipsis. Another thing that you can do with SVG is, as I said, it's DOM elements. SVG include DOM elements, so you can manipulate those DOM elements. For example, here I have a circle, and when the mouse is over the circle, I'm using the grow function, and when the mouse is out of the circle, I'm using the shrink. And what I'm doing in the grow and shrink is just setting the radius to multiply by 2 or divide by 2. Okay? These are the shrink and grow functions. Running that example, mouse over, okay, this is very, very simple stuff. You can do better than that, of course. You can create interaction with your SVG, and there are very cool demos like SVG Girl, okay, search it in Google, that will show you a movie of 30 or 40 seconds written only in SVG. Okay, so you can create animation, interaction with your SVG. A lot of companies use SVG for simple graphics that you want to draw instead of loading images, which loads a lot of kilobytes into the browser. Just use SVG. For example, if you want to draw a flag, okay, country flag. Wikipedia used that to draw country flags, and they removed that feature, I think, 1 year ago. Okay, so this is SVG, and SVG brings another model, graphics model that you can use. The difference between SVG and Canvas, again, it's pixel-based in Canvas, and SVG is vector graphics. More than that, if you have a lot of elements that you want to draw, please use Canvas, because SVG, when you are drawing SVG, you are drawing elements. You are creating DOM. Okay, so a lot of elements equals canvas. Fewer elements equals SVG. This is the split between where to use SVG and canvas. Okay, but if you want to draw 2D graphics, okay, use canvas, use SVG, and don't do that using Flash or Silverlight or any other plugin, browser plugin. As I said, I'm going to talk about a few APIs which are supported in the browser. One of them is geolocation. A lot of websites want to know where are you right now. For example, a website of a shop that a customer just opened because he's in front of the shop might want to pop up a sale for that customer. Okay, you enter the our website. I see that you are very close to our store. Come and you will get 50% off in if you buy pants. Okay, something like that. Other companies want to help you navigate. For example, who use Waze? Okay, not a lot of you. So you want to create something like Waze inside of the browser. How can you do that? So you can do that. One of the device access APIs that you can use is geolocation. Geolocation enables you to track the location of the browser. Okay? HTML5 enforce the browsers to check that you allow them to track your location. And the browser, if you say yes, will track your location and give it to the JavaScript. How it does that? Using two functions, get current position that runs once, or watch position that runs in an interval. Okay, you can use clear watch in order to clear the interval that is running. And what you need to give the get current position and what position is success and error callbacks that get that gives you the coordinations of the user, and do whatever you like with those coordinations. Let's see a live example. I hope it will work because I have a wire here and not wireless. Okay, so I have an HTML web page that loads virtual Earth script, the map control script of virtual Earth, and it loads jQuery and Modernizer. Inside of the web page, I have a div element that is going to represent the map, and I'm loading the map.js file. Here it is. Once the web page is loaded and ready, I'm checking whether geolocation is enabled. If it's enabled, I'm using the navigator.geolocation.getCurrentPosition in order to get the position of of my user. Once I get the position, I'm generating a map. The generate map uses virtual Earth objects, for example, virtual Earth map. It is setting that to the element with the ID map element. I'm using the E, the arguments that I got, dot chords, latitude, and longitude, in order to set the cursor that you the pinpoint that you're going to see, and I'm loading the map. The other stuff here just create a layer and put a push pin inside of that map. Okay, so let's see it in action. Hopefully it will work because I'm using a wire here and not. Okay, let's drill down and see how accurate it is. Okay, is it close to us? You didn't see a pop-up that jumps and that asked me whether I want to use geolocation because I said to Chrome yesterday, if I'm not mistaken, yes, and it saves that details. And you can see that geolocation works. Find me. It is very close to where we are right now. Okay. Cool. So we have device access. You might think what to do with that. Okay, spy on the users and etc. Or other stuff. But I will go with a pop-up of UNSL. Another API which is very important, in my opinion, humble opinion, is web walkers. As I said at the beginning of the session, you have only one UI thread or only thread running JavaScript. So if you want to do things concurrently, how can you do that? So let's see an example before we are delving into web walkers with things that happen when you are using some compilation which is very, very big. So let's run the third solution. In the browser, you can see an animated GIF. I'm calculating Fibonacci series. Let's put 5, compute. You don't see anything happening. Let's put 10, compute. Nothing happened. Let's put 40. Oh my god. Stop moving. Yes, I stuck the UI thread. Because I'm running a script here. Here's the script. Okay, compute regular that calculates the Fibonacci series. And that's all. But I have things working and that calculation is stuck in my UI thread. Okay, it's just a loop. It's running 35 times with the recursion. Okay, so what can we do? As I said, we have web walkers. Web walkers enables you to create a walker thread. The thread is given to you by the browser, okay? It is running in the background. It's not running anywhere else. It doesn't recognize the UI thread, doesn't it can't use anything that you loaded in the UI thread. So if you want to use underscore.js or anything else, you will have to load the scripts inside of the web workers, and it gets context, its own context. Okay. One thing that you need to know is it's not synchronized. You can't synchronize web workers. You have a messaging mechanism inside of web workers. Okay, you can send messages to the UI thread, and you can send messages from the UI thread to the web workers, but that's all. Okay, you can't synchronize it with semaphores or locking or something like that. Web workers run until they terminate. Okay, and they are supposed to be something that you do using the algorithms or things that are heavy on the background. If you want to use them for anything else, don't do that, because initializing web workers cost a lot of memory and a lot of time. Okay, the first initialization. Once you want to use the web worker, you just use worker new worker or the worker object, and you give him a script. Okay, that script is going to run inside the web worker. You can load more than one script. You can load inline scripts, okay, so you don't have to use a file. I wrote in my blog a post about how not to use files and go to the server to create a file for web worker or something like that. You can download or even create an inline web worker on the fly. Once you have the worker, you can wire into the on message event to get messages from the web worker, and the messages will arrive in the arguments.data property. Here is an example of how the script will look like, the worker.js that you saw me passing here. So you use any script that you like. Okay? It is running on the background, do whatever you like. In order to pass messages to the UI thread, use the post message function. Okay, you can wire into a on message event handler using the self.on message. Again, self, there is no this context inside of web worker, it's self context. Okay, and we'll see that in the example that I'm going to show you. So let's solve the problem from with the Fibonacci. Here is the complete solution with web workers. Okay, so I can compute regularly or with web worker. Let's compute with web worker. Let's put 40, compute. You see that the GIF, the animated GIF is still running. Yep, we got the data that we wanted to get, and everything is fine. Let's take a look at the script itself. So, compute web worker is just creating a new web worker with jscript.js, that file I'll show you later. You can see here that we are wiring into the on message event from the web worker, and we put the text box value equals the data that we got from the web worker, and we can post data to the web worker using the post message. In the jscript2.js, you can see the Fibonacci calculation, and you can see that I'm wiring into the self.addEventListener message. I'm wiring into the message event. Here, I'm getting the number that was written in the text box, and I'm calculating the Fibonacci series and posting it back to the UI thread. Okay, so you want to do things on the background, you can do things in the background.
Can you post the message multiple times in the background?
The question was, can you post multiple messages to the UI thread? Of course. So this is web workers. The last API that I'm going to show you is WebSockets. I think that this is one of the coolest things presented in HTML5. Okay. WebSockets enables you to create a bidirectional channel, TCP channel, between client and server. It's not HTTP anymore. You create an handshake between the client and the server in HTTP, and you upgrade it to a protocol of WebSockets. The WebSocket protocol sends only data. You don't have to use HTTP headers or things like that. Only data, JSON data, JavaScript patient data, is passed using WebSockets. Okay? And WebSockets can bring you the semi-real-time environment into the web. You will still have web latency, but it's very close to real-time in web. Okay? The web, again, it's not C++ or something like that. So what you're going to do is create a new WebSocket, and this API replaces things like long polling, okay, or comment, or other means to create or interact with servers for long runs. If you want to create inter-message communication or things like that, WebSockets is your candidate. I used it in using a library from Microsoft called SignalR, which is using it underneath, in a project. You can find it in the stores, DoubleJack. We sell a game, a blackjack game for a company, and that game was uploaded to the stores of Android and iOS, I think 3 weeks ago, something like that. In order to create a WebSocket, just pass it a URL. And you can see that the URL is using the WS protocol. Okay? If you want a secured socket, use the WSS, it's TLS security, using WebSockets. Once you have the object in hand, you can use event handlers like on open, on close, what to do when the socket is open, what to do when the socket is closed, and on message, what to do with the message that you get from the server. And you can use the send function from the socket object to send things to the server. Let's see a fancy, not fancy, but a nice example of working with WebSockets. We used an app called Draw Something 1 year, 1 year ago, 1.5 years ago. Okay, Draw Something was an app that you could use to create draw something on a surface and send it to friends, or something like that. So what I'm going to do right now is I'm going to open a WebSocket server. Okay, we're talking about HTML5, we're not talking about how to build WebSocket servers, but all the demos will be available in my blog, I think, tomorrow. I'm opening the WebSocket server, and first I'm going to run the web page here, and I'm going to open another browser, which is not Chrome, and let's put another instance here. The socket is open, welcome, let's draw something, let's go to Chrome, let's send from Chrome something, hello, send, let's go to IE, you see that I received hello. Let's take a look at the console, you can see here that I have two new connections, and I'm sending JavaScript data, JSON data, of the coordinates that I drawed here, and the message here, okay? Let's see the code that I wrote to enable that application. So the code here is very, very, I won't say simple, but it uses the WebSockets. Here we wire into the ready event. We check whether a WebSocket is supported using Modernizer. If it is supported, I'm creating a new WebSocket to my server. Once the socket is open, I'm just writing into the text box here that the socket is open. If it's closed, I'm writing that the socket is closed. And the magic happens here. Once the socket gets a message from the server, it just parses it as JSON. And once we have that JSON, I'm checking whether I have a message. If I have a message, then I write the message with the received into the text box. If I don't have a message, I use the draw function to draw using the array of points that I sent from the server. Another interesting function is the send. Once you use the send button, socket.send with the string with the message. That's all. So if you ask how I created the surface, the drawing surface, it's canvas. We saw canvas earlier. So I have a canvas with 2D context, and I'm listening to events of mouse down, mouse move, and mouse up in order to push into a message array the X and Y coordinates that I'm currently using. Okay? Once the mouse is up, then I'm using the send to send the string that I wrote here to the server. That's all. Once somebody is drawing, okay, the server, the draw function that you saw here, draw dot gets this function. Okay, I split the points that I got, and I just write to the canvas everything. Okay, that is not very simple, but if you look at the code after the session, you will see that it is very simple code to create, draw something. Okay, the same app, not the same app, but very close to the same app that you saw in stores, I think, 1 year ago. So it's very simple. Other HTML5 APIs that you might want to know. Okay, you can create notification using the browser with web notification. You can use File API to get a sandbox area from the browser and to write and read files using interactions using JavaScript. I'm talking about IndexedDB tomorrow, how to use an index database in the client side, which is supported in the client side. There are other APIs like cores, cross-horizon, resource sharing for cross-domain requests, and you know, at the end of the session, I have a resources page, a slide, and there is a link there that points you to all the APIs that are currently available in HTML5. So be patient, at the end of the session, I'll let you picture that slide. The last thing that I'm going to talk about in the session is CSS3. CSS3 is very revolutionary because up until CSS3, CSS2.1 just was written in one very big document. Okay? Very big document. If you want to read 1,000 pages of how to use CSS, go ahead. Okay? That's cool. But CSS3 itself just divides every model inside of CSS into models. Okay, so what happened is that the working groups of CSS could start working without being dependent on other models. More than that, CSS3 brings a lot of power to you as developers. For example, you can create animations. We'll see a simple demo in a minute. You can create transitions. You can create a lot of cool stuff with CSS. You don't need JavaScript for that. Okay. CSS3 also brings CSS colors, new ways to draw colors. You saw me using the RGBA function and the RGB function in the canvas demos. These are new in CSS3. Whoever wanted rounded corners in his web page? Yeah, how would you do that without border radius in CSS3?
Images.
images. I have an image on the right, an image on the left. Or you can create very, very, I say, hacky CSS in order to do that, those rounded corners. No more, okay? So you have border radius, you have text shadow, you have a lot of new ways to create style. You just need to know them. More than that, one of the biggest things that came with CSS3 is media queries. Who heard about responsive web design? Okay, so responsive web design, a lot of responsive web design techniques are related to media queries. Media queries enables you to query the medias like screen and etc. in order to impose something. If the query is false, then nothing happened. If the query is true, then the CSS here will be uploaded and would be used. Okay, so meta queries enables you to create fancy responsive web design, and we'll see a demo for that. Let's take a look at media queries. Okay, here's a media query that I've written. If the screen is less than 600 pixels, then omit the image that you are going to see in the div. One pitfall of media queries, always put them at the end of your CSS, okay? Always, because it, CSS is cascading, and you want them to react as the last thing that happened. Okay, so let's run this web page. And I have a picture here, let's see it in action. Okay, 600 pixels. No picture, yes picture, no picture, yes picture. Okay, so this this is meta query, this is very simple, but in order to use landscape and portrait and things like that, and do that very, very good, you will have to use meta queries if you have web pages and websites, okay? Another very nice example is animations. You use the keyframe, add keyframe rule in order to create animations. Here is the animation that I'm creating. I'm writing every frame in the animation. The browser will calculate each of the frames and will do the animation for me. I'm calling that animation my animation, and I'm imposing it using the animation attribute here, and I'm giving it a few attributes. For example, animation is linear, it will take 3 seconds, and it will be infinite. That means that it runs forever. Okay? One thing that you can see here is the dash, WebKit dash. This is a browser postfix. Okay? If you are using CSS3, not everything is supported in the browser. So please use the browser prefixes in order to be on the safe side. Okay, dash WebKit is for Chrome, dash O is for Opera, dash Moz is for Mozilla, and dash MS is for Explorer. Okay, let's see the animation in action. Okay, I have a blue rectangle that turns into red. No need for JavaScript here. You just get it from the web browser using CSS, and it will cost less in your CPU. The last example, border radius. Here it is. Using border radius, you can create fancy things like this. Okay? Oh, I could have used that in 2005 when I wrote a website, that I needed to create a lot of manipulation in order to do something like that. And that's an awful experience for web development. So this is CSS re-enhancement, and more than that, we have animation, transformation, fonts. You can create your own font with font face, border and background, and layouts, of course. We have Flexbox, a flexible box model for CSS, templating, multi-columns, like in newspapers, and a lot of more, grid alignment, okay? Things like that to create your stylish web page. So with that, let's talk about integration strategies, and I'll give you time for questions. So HTML5 is HTML. As I said at the beginning, if you know HTML, CSS, and JavaScript, you are 70% in the way knowing HTML5. Not everything is supported by the browsers, so you have a few things that you can do about it. The lowest common denominator is one thing. That means that if you need to support IE6, nothing is supported. Don't use HTML5. Sorry. If you need to support IE9, you need to know that geolocation is supported, but IndexedDB is not supported. Web storage is supported, but file API is not supported, and etc. There is a very informative website called caniuse.com. Use it to see what is supported in each browser. Okay. Vertical slice. Once you get into web, I got into a website that says. That told me, I see that Canvas isn't supported in your browser. Please download Chrome, or nothing will work. Okay, this is vertical slice. I'm saying to myself, not to my customers that will leave me because of those things that say to me that I need to download another browser or something like that. I'm telling to myself as a website writer, I have. To have that functionality, and I can't work without it. Okay, it's a vertical slice. The third thing is polyfills. I talked about it a little bit. I'm using it a lot. Just use a patch, a polyfill, to gap the differences between browsers. If something is not supported, then use a polyfill. If it's supported, cool, I'm using it. I'm using the API, use Modernizer to detect that or do the detection by yourself. And of course, fallback strategies. I showed you that in video and audio and Canvas, you have fallback strategies that you can use. Put inside of the element your object or flash or something like that in order to your website to function well and not to fall back into nothing that is working. Okay, so you have a few strategies that you can impose, pick the one that you like, and go with it. With that, any questions? Yes?
In SAP animation platform, it claims to be far superior to CSS3 transforms or jQuery UI, is that correct?
Right now, yes. I think that in a few years, if you will ask me again, I will say no.
Is that due to the current situation to support?
Yeah. Any other questions? Okay, so let's wrap up. The bottom line in HTML5, okay? Didn't talk about it, but I have to punchline the HTML5. HTML5, because it's in the browser, because it's HTML, CSS, and JavaScript, it is supported in all the devices that you can find and all the platforms. Okay? This is the punchline. You don't have to like it on one side, but you need to understand that it is supported, and you don't have to create a version of your app in Android, iOS, or whatever platform the vendors will invent. Okay? Most of the platform, not most, all of the platform has a browser, okay, and browser supports HTML5s. Without, here is the slide that I promised, resources, the slide deck and demos can be found in this link. A good website to start with HTML5 is HTML5 Rocks. I promised this link to all of the APIs that are currently available in HTML5. This is the dread.titab.com. It's a blog that is occasionally updated with new APIs. There is a big table there with of the current APIs that are available. You can go to my website and you can follow me on Twitter. And I want to thank you for coming, and I hope that you got what you wanted to get by understanding that HTML5 is here, it's going to stay here, and it is the modern web. It is the modern web. Thank you. Tomorrow I'll have another session that I'm going to drill down into one specific thing in HTML5. Okay, so if you don't know me, I'm Gil Fink. I'm working as a senior consultant and architect for a company called Sela Group. I'm a Microsoft MVP in the last 5 years. I wrote a book about Pro single page application development. If you want to know about SPAs, come and talk to me later on. Okay, I'm not going to talk about SPAs in this session. I'm also the writer of 4 Microsoft official courses. One of them is HTML5 programming. So I wrote different 4 books that you won't ever notice that I've written them, because Microsoft doesn't give you the credentials to put your name on the cover. Okay, that's Microsoft. What we are going to do in the 1 hour and 30 minutes that we are having is talk about what is HTML5. And to me, HTML5 is modern web, okay? That's what HTML5 means to me, and I hope that it will mean to you after I finish this talk. Later on, I'm going to talk about new elements. That's not the sexiest thing about HTML5, but you need to know what are the new elements and how to use them while you are programming. Later on, I'm going to talk about the big thing in HTML5, which is HTML5 JavaScript APIs. If you are not JavaScript fan like me, okay, you are going to not like my demos, because they include a lot of JavaScript. Yes, HTML5 brings a lot of new JavaScript. I'm telling you, it's not the future of the web, it's the web, okay? Definitely. And it is still under development. I mean, not all the specifications that I'm going to talk about are recommendation yet. Still, browsers like Chrome, Firefox, even Internet Explorer supports HTML5 and HTML5 APIs, but not all of them. Okay, so you need to understand what is supported and what is not. And more than that, a lot of specification change during time. There is one interesting thing about what happened with a specification called WebSocket, I think 3 years ago, that the WebSocket protocol version jumped 4 versions in 2 weeks. And that broke, I think, most of the websites that used WebSocket back then. Okay, so you need to know what is supported in browsers, and you need to understand that not everything is supported in the browser. So why you should use HTML5? And this is the really big question. So first of all, we have a lot of new HTML elements. Not sexy, okay, sorry. But those elements helps you to write your page structure more accurate, and it helps a lot to accessibility, searchability, and interoperability. Okay, because you have a way to communicate with other developers, and you don't need to use attributes like ID or class name or whatever to express what you want to express. As I said, we have 56 different JavaScript APIs that you can use. Good afternoon or good noon for you all. Are you feeling comfortable? It's packed room, and I saw people are leaving because there are no seats. Before I'm going to start the session, I want to tell you a story, a real story from my past. It was 5 years ago when my VP, my vice president of the company I work for, came to me because I'm leading the web department. And he said to me, Gil, we have two directions that I want you to pick. One is very sexy, very cool. It's a technology that comes from Microsoft. It is called Silverlight. And the other one is something, I don't know how to say that. It's specification, W3C, the conservatorium that writes specification, things like that. So I said to him, Ishai, sexy, whatever. Sexy, whatever. I'm going to whatever. 5 years later, where is Silverlight? Anyone saw that platform? Microsoft killed it. And HTML5 is something that is kicking and it's driving the modern web forward. And this is what we are I'm going to talk about. I'm going to introduce what is those specification in HTML5. Since it's an overview session, I won't drill down to a lot of things. I'm going to talk about a few highlights in HTML5 that I think that everyone needs to know, APIs. And when I say a lot, it's 56 different APIs that you need to know. I'm not going to talk about all of them. I'm going to talk about, I think, 4 or 5 APIs. Then I'm going to talk a little bit about what is CSS3 and what it means to you, okay? And we'll wrap up the session. I'll have a question and answer, and we'll summarize the session. Okay. Okay, so what is HTML5? What do you know about HTML5? Somebody told me that HTML5 is the Flash killer. Yes, it is. Okay, one of the things that brought the HTML5 to recognition by the community is a sentence that Steve Jobs told the newspapers. It is something like, "Over my dead body, Flash would be in iOS." Okay, so he is now dead, but still, Flash isn't supported in iOS, and. This sentence was said, I think, in 2009, and you can see that from that point of time, HTML5 gained a lot of attention. HTML5 is just HTML, CSS, and JavaScript. So if you've written HTML, CSS, and JavaScript, we are 70% of the way to know what is HTML5. Okay, it depends on HTML4, the early specification that were wrapped up in 1997. Okay, and everybody says that HTML5 is the future of the web. Right now, in the browsers, you just need to know that what are the specifications and what they are going to give you. And I'm going to say a lot. And of course, CSS. A lot of things that you could have done with CSS in CSS 2.1, you still can do with CSS 3, but CSS 3 brought a lot of new models into the world of the web, and you can even do transitions, animations, transformations, 2D or 3D transformations, etc., etc. A lot of cool stuff you can do with CSS. So what HTML5 include? So the first thing you can see here is semantics. We have new elements, we have structure elements, we have inline new elements, we have elements that help you to build the web page that you're building more accurate, more expressive, without those div elements all over the place. You know, div. You see that in websites. I open a lot of websites with my developer tools in my favorite browser, Chrome, and what you see is like an arrow. Okay? No need for that anymore. And we'll see those elements later on. Offline and storage. I'm not going to talk about offline and storage a lot because tomorrow I'm having a session about data-driven HTML5 applications. There I'm going to talk about those storage options. Okay? You can use databases in your front end using JavaScript and